All right, good afternoon, everyone. If you can grab the last bit of snacks and go ahead and take your seats, we're going to go ahead and get started with the first session for the afternoon here. I know it's been said before, but it's truly great to have you all with us this weekend. And as many of our speakers have pointed out, we hope you take what you learned here this weekend and you take that back with you to your high schools and continue to be strong advocates for conservative ideas at your school. And I hope you all come away from this weekend with a better understanding of who President Reagan was and why he believed so strongly that young Americans, just like all of you, are needed to protect, preserve, and defend freedom's principles at your high schools. Our next speaker is someone who understands that very well and has dedicated his life and work to helping inspire and educate young people. Before I get started with the introduction, a quick pop quiz. How many of you believe America is a great nation? Very good. And now, how many of you have been taught by a teacher that America isn't that great, that maybe we exploit people or are ruining the world? That's the problem, and that's why we're so glad all of you are here this weekend. Here at YAF, we teach real history, not some leftist fairy tale version of the truth that propagates debunked liberal ideas or glorifies tyrannical leaders like Che. You all get to hear not one but two history lessons today from our next speaker, a legendary history professor from Hillsdale and a friend of Young America's Foundation. Dr. Burt Folsom has worked alongside YAF for years to help us spread conservative ideas to thousands upon thousands of students at our conferences nationwide, just like this one. And he's also used his classroom at Hillsdale College to do the same. Folsom has shared his expertise and educated Americans with several books that present the truth about free market entrepreneurship superiority, the positive economic impact of limited government, and the disastrous effects of massive federal spending and imperial government regulation of American society. Some of his books, you have one of them there, The Myth of the Robber Barons. He also wrote books including New Deal or Raw Deal, How FDR's Economic Legacy Has Damaged America, and a book with his wife, FDR Goes to War, How Expanded Executive Power, Spiraling National Debt, and Restricted Civil Liberties Shaped Wartime America. Hope you'll give our next speaker a lot of attention and a warm YAF welcome, Dr. Burt Folsom.
Thank you, Spencer. Thank you, Spencer. I'm glad to be here with you and talking about American history, which I teach at Hillsdale College, as Spencer was saying. Let me start out here this way. How many have one of these, right? Yeah, a lot of you. Yeah, a lot of you. How many have talked today, you know, here at the conference or in between talks or at lunch or something, with somebody from another state? Look at that. A lot of you. How many maybe even with somebody 1,000 miles away? Yeah. So, I mean, you have to think, you just take it for granted. Oh, did I today? Well, I will. If I didn't, I probably will tomorrow. And you have to think, to kind of bring us back here, that that idea of communicating to people that far away is fairly new in history. And most people could not communicate, at least directly. Now, I'm not talking about maybe either sending a letter. I'm talking about communicating directly with someone. Unless you, hey, hello there! I mean, it's that kind of thing that you could communicate about that far. I mean, maybe smoke signals, you know, or something. But the idea of communicating with someone a long way away is a fairly recent phenomenon. Let me put it this way. Since I'm a college professor, you people are all students. You know, if we were hanging out and you were all my students, which would be a lot of fun, we would, let's say we're 100 years ago. Our class, and I'm the professor, and you're my students, and we're hanging out. If one of us wanted to contact somebody in another state, a couple hundred miles away, could we have done that 100 years ago?
Difficult.
Difficulty. Elaborate on that.
Well, because it's not as easy nowadays where you have social media and email. You would probably have to use something like a telegram or a telephone.
Okay.
Well, if it was 100 years ago, it would be the telephone.
Well, it could be either.
Yeah.
Did you hear that? Very good. The telephone is around then, mm-hmm. And the telegraph. But that would be it. Those would be the two possibilities. Now, what about 200 years ago? If we're together in a class 200 years ago, in the early 1800s, would you be able to communicate with someone a couple hundred miles away instantly, or at least in a very short period of time? Would you be able to do that 200 years ago? Right? No, you would not. Which came first, the telegraph or the telephone?
Telegraph.
Telegraph came first. No, you're right. And the telegraph actually was invented in 1844. And so it was at that moment that you could communicate with someone beyond your range. Now, it was invented by Samuel Morse. And of course, since he had a wire, and the idea is you hit on a wire and the impulses can be transferred, there's ways miles away, and then somebody's receiving impulses. And he said, if we had those impulses represented by letters, say the Morse code, we could do it. Like the letter E was just a dot. You know, the letter F is dot, dot, dash, dot. So the whole point is you've got, and that's representing letters, which can be made into words, which of course can be put into sentences, and then you can communicate with someone at a distance. That was the first effort. That's the forerunner of this. And it was about 170 years ago. Now, here's the point here, as we watch the development of this technology and this communications industry, and that of others. Is this industry better advanced by the government? Or is it better advanced by, say, a free market system where people are producing and responding to markets and incentives and going forward? Now, that was a question we were asking in the United States. Because in the 1840s, we tended, not always, but we tended to answer that question by saying government. No, that's actually true, including the telegraph. Samuel Morse invented it, right? A free enterprise invention. But in order, he said, I think that the government ought to be involved in this, in the national interest. He said that. And the government paid to string the first telegraph wire in this country from Washington, D.C., which makes sense, it's the nation's capital, 40 miles away to Baltimore. That was the first telegraph wire. And, I mean, we tried doing it underground, and that didn't work very well, so we tried overground wires. And then the idea was you had somebody in an office in Washington who would, if he got a message, he would do the tapping. Then somebody in Baltimore would be receiving the dots and dashes and write it down, and then the person who had a message would come in and get it. I think I like this better. Do you? Yeah, we've made some progress in 173 years, but that's where it started. And what I'm saying is the government, now, this is always amazing to me, and so I want to quote this because I want to get this wording exactly right. When 1844, the telegraph's invented, and it's turned over to the government to operate, in Morse's words, in the national interest. Because if a single entrepreneur had it, maybe it could be abused. We need the government to run it in the national interest. The Postmaster General, who was in charge of the telegraph office, the first one, said this, trying to explain it to people. The telegraph, so powerful for good or evil, cannot with safety to the people be left in the hands of private individuals, uncontrolled by law. That states it pretty bluntly, doesn't it?
Was that Morse?
This was Cave Johnson, who was the Postmaster General for President James K. Polk. And he said, the telegraph, so powerful for good or evil, cannot with safety to the people be left in the hands of private individuals, uncontrolled by law. So, the government is going to be running the telegraph business. And the interesting, I mean, imagine all the forerunner of the internet and all of this, it's government operated. And
it's going to be, they're thinking, well, the profits then are going to go to the government. Well, the government hires bureaucrats to be in Washington, D.C., secretaries to take the messages, and a Morse code operator, of course, in both cities. And then you have repairs possibly on the wires. So you have some expenses, and then you charge, of course, for the telegrams that are sent. So you have expenses, you know, up here, and then paying the people, and then possibly repairing telegraph wires. And then you have the revenue from all the telegrams. And so, naturally, you're probably thinking, wow, this is going to be a real moneymaker for the government. What's interesting is the first 6 months the government had control of the telegraph, they lost money. In fact, if you looked at a revenue, for every dollar that the government earned in people paying for telegrams, for every dollar, expenses were $6. If some of you have parents who are in business, I don't think you need to ask them, hey, Dad, is it good to gain $1 in sales and spend $6 for every dollar we get? You know, that is a loser, but that's what it was. Now, when this was brought to the attention of Polk and the Postmaster General, they said, well, yeah, it's beginning. People are just beginning to learn about it. Wait till they know more. We're going to start making money. This is a money machine. Have a little faith in government. The next 6 months, the ratio was not going to be 6-1 anymore. This time, for every dollar that the government spent, they ended up spending $10. In other words, it got worse rather than better. And at the end of the year, it was a drag on the federal debt, and we're dealing in an era where that meant something. It meant that you had to run for re-election on you had a big money loser. And so then the government decided, you know, earlier, remember Cave Johnson, I had his quote, the telegraph, so powerful for good or evil, cannot with safety to the people be left in the hands of private individuals uncontrolled by law. They changed their minds and decided maybe it could be left in the hands of individuals. Or as they worded it, dumped on some individual. In other words, we're going to privatize the telegraph. We're going to turn it over, and no longer are we going to get those losses. So the telegraph is turned over to private enterprise. And in the purchasing of it, you had a man named Ezra Cornell, who founded a company named Western Union. And they were going to deliver telegrams. And people, you know, a lot of the government people thought, oh, wait till he goes bankrupt and it's not our money anymore. And what happened was kind of interesting. The first thing he did was he borrowed money to go deeper in debt to build and extend the telegraph line from Baltimore to Philadelphia, then from Philadelphia to New York. So now we have Washington, D.C. to New York telegram. The moment he had New York, then he started advertising saying, if you want the latest quotations from the New York Stock Exchange, get a telegram and you can get regular service on any stock that you want. In other words, if you want to be the forefront of financial services industry, you have got to have access to this telegraph because in D.C. we can instantly transfer the price of a stock to now at least to Washington, D.C. Or, he said, if you're in Washington, D.C., and you have a bill that's passed and you want to get to know about it, he started advertising, hey, move up the line here, get telegrams, and you can find out instantly about some bill. Then some steamship companies thought, hey, I need to know whether it's safe to send a steamship into South Carolina or send a steamship into Boston or a steamship into New York because of wind condition and weather. Why don't we have, it would be nice if we had telegraph services there. Ezra Cornell extended them all around the nation. He started advertising, keep up with family members in different places, send them a telegram on their birthday. We had an explosion under private enterprise. In fact, just 6 years after this disaster, we had 23,000 miles of telegraph wire. By the time we got to 1860, we had telegraph wire in California. So you could communicate, if you're in San Francisco or Los Angeles, you could communicate to someone in, or here in Santa Barbara, you could communicate with someone in New York. Again, find out stock market prices, anything else, you could get that information. 10 years later, we put an underground telegraph wire into, or in the ocean telegraph wire, we covered it up, in the Atlantic Ocean, and we reached England. So now you could communicate from New York to London. The world is about to be connected because of this remarkable invention. The government had this result. Private enterprise, 25 years later, it was around the world with hundreds of thousands of miles. The government couldn't make 40 little miles work and lost money every month they owned it. It tells us something. By the way, how many had textbooks or teachers who told you this story? Good. Good, another one. But don't you think this is something that might belong in an American history class somewhere? Look at the implications of this for should we turn enterprises over to the government or should we have them run privately? You have to ask the question, why did it fail? Were government bureaucrats just inherently stupid or what? Well, I know some may think so, but I like to look at the incentives that differ between private enterprise and government. If you're operating as a government official and you're in that room transmitting Morse code, right? You're not exactly looking to get more customers. In fact, if nobody comes in for 3 hours, you can just goof off for 3 hours. I mean, you could just do nothing. I was going to say, you can't be on your phone, you know, telegraph, can't do that, but you could read a magazine for 3 hours. You could do what you want. If nobody comes in, you get paid to do nothing. Oh, no, there's a customer. Oh, shoot, now I got to work. Okay, what's your message? And I hope it's a short one. Right? And the bureaucracy doesn't know, and they're not putting any money into this. They don't know. But even if somebody in the bureaucracy had figured out, hey, we ought to connect to New York City and do stock prices, he or she would not benefit from the profit. You're employed by the government. And if it would have lost money, if it would have been a disaster, you'd get fired. Whereas when Ezra Cornell started Western Union, if it's successful, he becomes a millionaire, which he did. He started Cornell University. And if it fails, well, that's no good. But he said, part of the reasons I got in here is because I want to make it work, and I'm going to put my whole time into figuring out ways to try to persuade people that it's a good idea to send telegrams. And so what we have is a remarkable situation where the incentives for the entrepreneur are to expand, to advertise, to get people to think of ways to use his business. With the government bureaucrat, the less you do, the happier you are. You're a paid official. It's taxpayer dollars. Hey, you lose money, it's other people's money, not yours. No big deal. And I hope nobody comes in to visit me today and send a telegram. The incentives are different. The results are different. Now, what I wish I could say we learned our lesson right away. We went into steamships and railroads and had the same disasters. We had a government-operated steamship company. It was a total failure. I described that in the first chapter on Cornelius Vanderbilt, who was the private owner who competed against the government enterprise and was successful. The second chapter in Myth of the Robber Barons is on the Transcontinental Railroads. And there you had the same thing. We had the government building the Transcontinental Railroad across the country. Some of you may know about the Union Pacific, Central Pacific. And we said, okay, It has to be done by the government in the national interest. And so we got people who we thought would be good, and we said, now you lay that track, and we'll pay you $16,000 across flat land, Union Pacific in Nebraska, to lay that track. And the Union Pacific figured out, hey, our costs of building the track are about $10,000 to $12,000 a mile, and we're getting $16,000 from the government. And so all of a sudden, the railroad began to look. You know, they're saying, go through Nebraska westward. Here's Omaha. Go out to the Rocky Mountains this way. And they said, well, wait a minute. We're making $4,000 a mile, which is a lot of money back then. I mean, the annual income was about $200 or $300. $4,000 a mile. The railroad began not to look like this, but like this. See? The incentives were not to build an efficient railroad. We paid by the mile. The incentives were to build a crooked railroad to get as many miles in Nebraska as you could get. And so he made money, and we had a terrible railroad, until finally a private entrepreneur, James J. Hill, came along and built a transcontinental, the Great Northern Railroad, now the Burlington Northern, built that railroad straight across the country. It was successful. This one, I guess I don't need to emphasize too much, it failed. It went bankrupt. It had to be rebuilt. And I was telling this story in great detail to an audience one time, and I had a guy raise his hand and said, I used to work. I spent my whole life working on the Union Pacific Railroad. Oh, well, this will be interesting. And then he looked up and he said, and we're still trying to straighten that railroad out. Right? In other words, the thing was just a disaster. So the government incentives are different, and we just had tremendous success. Now, here's where it gets fun. And as a history teacher, I don't get to say this very often, and so I'm going to say it, and I'm going to have fun saying it. We learned from history. We learned from history. Well, one time we did. Repeat it after me. We learned from history. One time. Say it. One time. Yes. Now I get to tell about the one time. We said after the Civil War, whoa, we're not going to do this anymore. No. Failure. We may catch up and become a great nation. England was way ahead of us in economic development. They invented the railroad. They had the railroads first. They had better canals and all that. Now, we did invent the telegraph, so I mean, we're in there. But I mean, England was way ahead of us. And a lot of people here, with steel and textiles, you know, making clothes and all that, the Industrial Revolution, we may catch up with England, we may not, but we're going to do it privately. Now, what is fascinating is that after we said that, we had this flurry of economic development in the United States. And I want to describe to you, now we're not going to have any more subsidies, in the industries like oil, with John D. Rockefeller, or steel, with Andrew Carnegie from Pittsburgh. With those industries, the United States took world leadership. In fact, Rockefeller was so good in oil, he became the first billionaire in U.S. history. We had, his company, Standard Oil, had a market share in the world of over 50%. One American entrepreneur did transactions in 50%+ of all the oil business in the world. He had 85% in the United States and over half of the world. So you had some absolutely spectacular people. Nobody could sell cheaper than he did, 8 cents a gallon. Mainly back then for lighting, you know, for lamps. But hey, we've got other inventions. Eventually it's going to be used, as you know, for gasoline mostly. The telephone is invented, so the telegraph goes into its next phase of communications. The telephone invented, right? Who invented that?
Alexander Graham Bell.
Yeah, well, you know, Alexander Graham Bell, he absolutely did. invent the telephone in the 1870s. So you get the next, you see what I mean? Technology's now starting to build on itself as you get improvements privately. And I mean, I know that's weird. You've got the telephone. I mean, a call comes in. Well, I wonder who this is. You've got somebody trying to call. You know, you're not going to pick it up there. Well, wrong number, I guess. I'm glad it wasn't a telemarketer the first call. But he had it set up, and he was able to call his friend from quite a distance away. And so we had that. Now, I know it's weird because the first telephone, you didn't have a ring. So you had to agree to someone, we're going to pick up at a certain time. So you'd have to do a telegram to somebody to say, let's talk at a certain time. And then you'd just pick up the phone and wait for the other person to come. But of course you get a ring, you know. I mean, a lot of this, it's like, hey, it starts at one. Another invention during the late 1800s was the game of basketball. Well, I mean, the game of basketball started and there was no backboard. You know, so we finally figured out, you know, those three-pointers sometimes just go over and out of bounds. Let's get a backboard. So, I mean, that had to come later. You have to make these improvements. You start with something small, and even the telegraph, after all, started with a short distance, and then you keep expanding and growing. But to do that, it takes entrepreneurs with a vision for what can be accomplished. Yeah, the telephone comes in. These are, now, sometimes we call this period of the late 1800s the Gilded Age. Mark Twain was the one who gave it that name. You'll hear it sometimes in textbooks called the Gilded Age. Say from about 1865 or 70 to 1900 or maybe 1902 or 3, the last three decades or so. I mean, that's a pretty short period, but look at these inventions. The telephone, the typewriter, see, and it's the keyboard from that we use on our phones. The letter placement is exactly the same as it was on those first typewriters. The telephone, the typewriter, electricity, right? Thomas Edison is underway. And he's going to invent movies during this time period too, silent movies. So you have movies, but you have electricity. And you have the automobile. And if you go into the very early 1800s, you have the airplane. I'd say probably most of us kind of use those regularly here. Like, how many got here by maybe car or airplane? Yeah? And how many have used the typewriter keyboard in the last day or two? How many are kind of glad, even in Santa Barbara, that we have electricity? You know? Yeah. Yeah, we're using all of this. It was all invented in a short period of time. We got the government out. It was a period of incredibly limited government. All of those inventions. Now, I know some people say, well, yes, you, and we had a $3 billion national debt after the Civil War, starting the Gilded Age. We had 28 years of budget surpluses. And we whittled that debt down to $1 billion. Isn't that an incredible commitment? That meant that people said, these guys are serious, and England began to invest over here because the money is safer, because these guys are serious. They're turning their entrepreneurs loose. They're not going into debt. They're not, therefore, going to default on any money we loan them. Therefore, let's invest in the United States. And the United States is going to be the center of world economic development by 1900. We eliminate two-thirds of the national debt. Boy, this is fun to teach on this. You know, at Hillsdale, I like to say, I just want to teach a course that starts in 1865 and ends in 1900, and I don't want to think about the stuff after that. And we're just going to have fun talking about this every day and get everybody pepped up and charged up. Yeah, it is something to get charged up about. Now, I wanted to mention some other things, too, because you had, I know, you might be thinking, well, what about the social, you hear the safety net. Don't you need government for all of that? No, because the Constitution strongly implied, and the founders made it clear that this is what they meant, is that you don't have government help people, you have people help people. George Washington was a member of the Volunteer Fire Department, and after he was president, he was out there manning the bring the hoses and the water buckets and pass them down. Yeah, if you have a problem, you solve it locally. Like, you know, the Humane Society is founded. If you have a problem, you start it locally. Okay, you have deaf people. Okay, then you start a college for deaf people. Gallaudet College in Washington, D.C., founded by Alexander Graham Bell. You need colleges to train people and educate them. You start Cornell University. You start Vanderbilt University in Tennessee. And others, you begin to get the university's private financing. You get libraries. Andrew Carnegie, an immigrant from Scotland, is the second wealthiest man in the United States next to Rockefeller. And he spends a lot of his money, he gives it away to start libraries, because he said, I never had a chance to go to college, but I could go to a library and read books and learn things. And he started over 2,500 libraries in this nation where he gave financing. But Carnegie was very interesting. He gave half the funding. He said, you raise the other half yourself to show you're committed and interested, and I'll supply the other half. And we started, as I said, over 2,500 libraries in the United States. Rockefeller was worth the first billionaire. He gave away over $500 million of his dollars. He said, let's see if we can help medical research, diseases like meningitis. Let's see if we can help. The South is plagued in their cotton crop by the boll weevil. Let's invest in scientists to help cure the boll weevil. He helped start orphanages. And then he said, black people need to have opportunities. He was a big giver to Tuskegee Institute, founded by Booker T. Washington. Then he said, that's good, but we need colleges for black women. And nobody seemed interested, so he said, I will start a college for black women myself, and I'll name it after my wife, Laura Spelman. So Spelman College in Atlanta becomes an institution for black women set up by the entrepreneur John D. Rockefeller. He was very, in my life, he said, the smartest thing I ever did was make Jesus my savior. The second smartest thing I did was make Laura Spelman my wife. And he said, because I made those two decisions right, I was positioned to do well in business, which is rather modest considering that he was the first billionaire, and nobody, including Carnegie, even had half a billion, which means that he was giving away more than anybody had ever possessed. I'd say he was pretty successful. He was a tither. That's what he did. He says, ever since he was in high school, he gave away 10% to churches, he gave one to an anti-slavery society. He was always interested in black education. So what I'm suggesting here is you have a lot of entrepreneurs who are doing well. Some didn't give a thing. Some didn't give anything. Some, like Rockefeller, gave huge amounts. Others gave in between. But the point is, you got the Salvation Army for down-and-out homeless people it started. You know, I mentioned the Humane Society for animals. You get all of these organizations jumping into gear because different entrepreneurs see different needs and they say, I want to get involved in that. We have people helping people. Now, a lot of people, politicians, said, well, here's the chance for the government to get involved. And sometimes you had to have presidents who were just say no. Like President Grover Cleveland. He vetoed 414 bills in the 1880s. Don't you try to sneak something unconstitutional by me. They even had an aid, $10,000 for a drought that was in Texas and the people were starving. They said, we'll help starving people. He said, no, I'm vetoing it. He said, because private people ought to help those people in Texas, and let me start by making my contribution. Various newspapers publicized the need in Texas from this drought. And the government the politicians had passed a bill to give them $10,000, which would be several hundred thousand in today's money. But that bill did not pass because it passed, but it did not become law because Cleveland vetoed it. But they raised almost $100,000 in private money. And Cleveland said, that's the way we do it. Not rush to the government to try to get a check. People helping people. And when they do, those people who are helping have a good feeling about it. Hey, I helped those people who are hurting. Bell said that about Gallaudet College. I'm glad to give deaf people an opportunity to get an education. Rockefeller said that with black men and women. I'm glad to help people who have had it hard in life to get an education. Carnegie thought this with libraries. I'm glad to have people who are immigrants like me who come over to this country. They don't have much. At least they can learn and they can read and learn something from the libraries free, and that will help them in lieu of an education. All of these people meeting these, this was the way, and it's why we had so much prosperity, literacy rates increasing, and a remarkably prosperous society. Now, you say, well, what if somebody's burned out by a fire? The Red Cross was founded in 1881. You can sort of see all of this going together. The system of freedom here is producing enormous results. Even, you know, you think of the time zones. You probably think, well, the government must have set up the time zones. No, they didn't. It was done privately. You think, well, the states must have been involved. The states weren't even involved. Railroads needed to have time zones because when they were going across the country, it was weird. You couldn't just have one time. And so they thought, we've got to adjust to where the sun is. And so they set up the time zones. It was done privately. Yeah. It didn't even occur to anybody. Well, let's get government involved. Set up privately. Now, with all this, with the debt decrease and all of this, we have a situation in 1900 where you probably heard the Progressive Era. This is, and I know you're thinking, well, if we have this in the Gilded Age and it's working so well, and it is, how can we then go and say, oh, let's try a little big government, which we did during the Progressive Era. It has to start somewhere. And one of the places it started was this. And see if you can see the subtle increase here in government. It started by saying, you know what the Americans were saying? We went through a war with Spain and England, you know, Spanish-American War, England and is rearming, and so is Germany, and there could be wars. And you know what's bothersome here? That Germany and France and England are experimenting with these flying machines. And the idea is, if they can invent a flying machine and then fly over a country and drop the bomb on them, you have an enormous advantage, because now it's, hey, let's get all our troops in a fort and then sneak over the edge and start shooting at anybody who comes up to us. I think it's rather obvious. You'd come over with the airplane, boom, and everybody in the fort is annihilated, and then that is a good offensive action against them, effective. So here's the way the debate took place in the United States. Okay. Listen to this. Oh, I know free markets are working. I know the telegraph and the transcontinental railroads didn't work so well when we had the government involved. But you know what? You can never tell when these inventions are going to come in. I mean, the telegraph came in 1844. It could have. I mean, what if Morse hadn't done it? Or what if Alexander Graham Bell had been late on the telephone? Or, you know, can you just sit back and wait and say, oh, let's hope somebody invents an airplane? While they're sitting there putting their best efforts and all their money into that airplane. And then we're sitting there, oh, I hope we can invent an airplane. And they've got the airplane, and they're flying it over New York City, dropping bombs, and we're saying, well, we believe in free markets, and we want somebody to invent an airplane. Isn't that an interesting? Therefore, we've got to get the government involved. Let's try to find somebody who appears to be advanced in this field. Give him a subsidy, then we invent the airplane. Mm-hmm. Oh, I know that free markets work a lot, but this is definitely one time we need the government. That's a tough one. Some of you think of, how would you like to be on the receiving end of that one? Yeah. And so we began to bring before Congress people who might be able to invent an airplane. The person who seemed like the most likely prospect was a man named Samuel Langley. Samuel Langley was head of the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. He had worked at Harvard before. He had had vast experience, and he was considered very much an aristocrat. believed in hiring talented people with educations, which is, I mean, that's okay, but I mean, that was where his mind was. And he said, he had written a book called Experiments in Aerodynamics. And he was considered an expert on the possibility of flight, and he was an American. In fact, he had flown a miniature plane with a little engine across the Potomac River in D.C. in the 1890s. And they brought him before Congress. Could you do this on a big scale and invent the airplane? And he said, I, Samuel Langley, volunteer to receive a federal subsidy. Isn't that gracious? He volunteers to receive a federal subsidy. And he said, yes, I will. Yes, I will. And he said, however, I may need two attempts. As good as I am, it's just possible that my first one will not be so successful. And so I wish to have a subsidy to try two attempts. And that's what we did. And America was now following Britain, Germany, and France in the federal subsidies to be the first country to fly. Langley immediately went to work. Langley had a theory that you needed a good, strong engine, that was the key. His theory, he loved to be interviewed by the media. You know, he would talk with them, the Washington Post and all these people. And there in Washington, he said, yes, yes, a big engine is needed. And he liked to use illustrations. And he said, it's like a skater skating on the ice. He says, sometimes if the ice is a little bit thin, the skater can skate just fine until the skater stops. And then, boom, the skater falls in. And he said, I see the principle being the same with an airplane. That it takes a while to get up in the air, but once you're in the air, you just keep going and you don't stop, and we get a good engine that can keep you going for a long time. Now, if you had watched his enterprise, the thing that would surprise you, it was all taking place on a houseboat out, or at least the plan was the launching. You know, you think of a runway, right? He was going to launch out of a houseboat in the middle of the Potomac. Because his theory was one that you needed to catapult the plane out of a slingshot. How many have played Angry Birds? It's the Angry Birds effect. Right. That's the same principle here. You pull back, and then you launch it, and then you're in the air, and then the engine keeps you going. See? So he got a pilot. Naturally, it was from the Ivy League. Interestingly, it was from Cornell. Ezra Cornell, had he lived to see this, it would have been interesting. But it was from Cornell. It has to be Ivy League. That's with Samuel Langley, the way it was. And so you had a pilot. He was 21 years old. And so you get him out there, and zoom, you get that pilot. Now, we had before the first flight that Langley was going to try, he had a compass that was sewn into the pants of his pilot so that when he was flying around, he would know which way he's going. He got a compass there. And because you may be in the air for, half an hour, who knows? And, you don't want to just be flying over and end up in Atlanta, Georgia, right, with nowhere to land. So you can then land it perhaps in the Potomac, circle around and land. He had a 21-gun salute to let everybody in D.C. know, here it comes. The launch came. They pulled back the slingshot device. Shot in the air. It collapsed right into the Potomac. I want to quote from my book, which is called Uncle Sam Can't Count. I want to quote. I thought, let's quote the Washington Post. They were out there the whole time. They explain in 13 words what happened and how they evaluated it. Their editorial went like this. Any stout boy of 15 could have skimmed an oyster shell much further. Any stout boy of 15 could have skimmed an oyster shell much further. Now, Langley said, not to worry. It's one of those things. Edison had trouble at first, too. We're going to get this worked out. I have one more attempt. We'll iron out the kinks, and the second one will be amazingly successful. The second launch was scheduled for December 8th, 1903. And we had the same, by the way, the same pilot agreed to come back for more. They fished him out of the water. He almost drowned, but he made it. They got him. They got his lungs cleared out and all of this. And they got him this time we didn't have a 21-gun salute. It was kind of quieter this time. But we pulled in there. We pulled the device back. Poosh! This time it was a little more embarrassing. Half the plane flew off. And I mean, you imagine you're sitting there flying that thing, and well, there goes half the plane. This may not be the most successful launch here, but the pilot again went into the ocean, and amazingly, again, they were able. They had to spend a lot of time underwater. They got him, and they pulled him up, and he was alive. And this time the remarks were they were even less pleasant. Let me read them for you here. The Boston Herald said, Langley ought to abandon flying machines and focus instead on submarines. The New York Times said, a flying machine may yet be built, but only if mathematicians and engineers work at it for the next 1 million years. We can get it, but it's going to take 1 million years. The New York Times was incorrect in its analysis. It was off by 999,999 years and 356 days. 9 days after it made that statement, the Wright brothers, two uneducated bicycle mechanics from Dayton, Ohio, with $2,000 of their own money, because when the government came around and said, would you like a subsidy? They said, we will never take one. It's our own money we're spending. With $2,000 of their own money, they experimented for a couple sessions in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, because they liked the wind currents there. They watched the birds, and they noticed the birds had curved wings, would cup them, and so they had cupped. They were trying to do everything they could, because their theory was a little different from Langley's with the shoot it in the air with the slingshot. Their theory was you need to have, they had gliders. They tried gliders and wind. They said, hey, the key thing is to try to steer this thing. In fact, when they were trying, they had Orville and Wilbur Wright. One of them would be on the plane, on top of it. And you'd have your foot guiding a rudder, on the tail and steering the thing. They were trying to do that. That was a key thing. You did gliders and then would try to go off of a launch, a modern-day runway, except it's kind of a launch. And then get the engine going and go up and then try to swirl around by steering it. 9 days after Langley's second flight, the Wright brothers were successful. They launched it. I love this comment here and this is neat. The San Francisco Chronicle says this. The destruction of Langley's machine should put an end to congressional appropriations of any kind in every field of experiments which properly belongs to private enterprise. That's the old view kicking in. and the Wright brothers made it work. Now, what gets incredibly interesting here is that the Wright brothers experimented for two more years, and they had their own airfield back in Dayton, and they said, we'd like to sell this commercially. They weren't so much at the time thinking of passengers, although that's a long-run thing. See, remember, their first flight was only 12 seconds, and that day, the first day they flew, they only had the best flight was almost a minute. And they thought, most passengers want to go somewhere more than a minute away. So we're going to have to make this better before we can make it profitable for passengers. But it has military implications, too. And let's wait till we can get this thing so it's 15, 20 minutes at least in the air and then sell it to the government. So they waited, and they had the right flyer, and they were going to sell it to the government for $25,000, which would be about $500,000 in today's money. So they have the right flyer, a plane, and they said, we can get in the air for 15 minutes. And then the government heard this and said, well, now I don't know if we ought to buy this or not, because Samuel Langley said, I would like to try another government subsidy. And here was what one of his big supporters said, who sponsored the subsidy, made this statement. To do otherwise than fund Langley would be to confess that the War Department did not know what it was doing when it provided the first fund. Isn't that clever? Then, after that, while we were considering, now we have a choice. We can either fund Langley or we can fund the Wright brothers. And we had a third choice because the French came over here and said, look, all this business with these flying machines, that's not the tech wave of the future. We're high tech over here in France. The wave of the future for getting distances in the air is not airplanes. The method that is the successful method that we can use is helium balloons. Only it was hydrogen they were doing it back then. You go in the air with a balloon, and then you transfer over. And if you want to drop a bomb, you can. Of course, somebody said, well, yeah, if somebody's shooting bullets at your balloon, that isn't so comfortable either, you know. But, well, you got to get it up there so they can't reach the balloon. And there were discussions about the balloon. But the French said, we will sell you this balloon because that's the tech wave of the future in flight. Congress felt they had to do something, and they had three choices. They could buy the Wright brothers plane, they could fund Langley with the $25,000 for another flight, or they could buy a balloon. And I have a question for you. Which one do you think they took? No, I'd like to take a poll. Yeah, we're gonna ask all three choices. They either could buy the Wright brothers plane, they could fund Langley for another flight, or they could buy the French balloon. How many think that they bought the Wright brothers airplane? Okay. So about five or six. That isn't too many, actually, out of about 100 or 85 here. How many think that they gave Langley another subsidy? Oh, my goodness. What a cynical group of students. How many think they bought the balloon? In this case, a majority of you say that they gave Langley a subsidy to do it again. A majority of you think they gave the money to Langley. And in this case, the majority. Is wrong! Hey! They bought the balloon. They bought the balloon. However, we became suspicious because the French sold us the balloon, but they invited Wilbur Wright over to do a test run on his plane.
And that made Congress suspicious that something fishy was going on here, especially when Wilbur Wright went over to France and flew for an hour making figure eights in the air for the French people. At that point, Congress decided we will be high-tech in two different fields and we'll buy the airplane. And so they had the balloon and the airplane and figured we will be okay in the next wave of technology. Now, I conclude this to say, look at this. From the telegraph, the transcontinental disaster, and then the steamships, and then you have private enterprise and all these inventions, and then the airplane, we tried them both again, and you get the private enterprise working. I want to suggest, you say, well, we've really learned. Here's a quotation from Vice President Biden. Joe Biden said this. He said, in the contest between can free enterprise do the work right or can government do the work right, he said, government is the answer. I want to quote him exactly. Every single great idea of the last 200 years has required government vision and government incentive. I look for the day when the response to the audience, reporters were sitting there, oh yes, let's rush and quick report it on our network. Fake news. Fake news, that's good. Isn't that interesting? You people right now, thinking telephone, electricity, right? Automobile, airplane. And when the government got in, it was a disaster. Almost none of these examples, though, are in a textbook. Often when a failure happens, like Langley's airplane or the government-operated telegraph, it disappears into a memory hole, which is why historians have to dig deep. Because for public policy debates on what we do, do we rely on government to make decisions and politicians to make decisions regarding the economy and inventions? Or do we trust entrepreneurs with low tax rates to make those decisions? The historical record is clear. It's not clear in many of your classes because much of this is not taught. Young America's Foundation invites many of us here to try to tell you people, give you a factual basis for your education. And I hope send you back, you can educate some of your classmates. Because in the late 1800s, the triumph of American free enterprise occurred, and it's something to celebrate. Thank you. You have time, Jolie, for... Okay, no, that's fine. Go ahead. I'll turn it over to Jolie here.
Thank you, Dr. Folsom. Let's give it up for Dr. Folsom one more time. Hey, all right, students, go ahead, take a quick 2-minute break. We need to reset the stage, so go ahead, grab some coffee if you need it. But otherwise, stay in the room. Thanks.